Hi to all. So today we are going to discuss chelation or complexing agents or complexation. So what does it mean? Chelation is a type of bonding or ions and molecules to metal ions. So it involves the formation or presence of two or more separate coordinate bonds between a polydentate, that means a multiple bonded ligand, and a single central atom. So let's see how it is. So we need a metal here. So to this metal, so we are going to see the attachment of a ligand. So imagine we have an ethylene diamine. It's going to make the bond like this with the metal. Okay. So our central atom is nothing but M, indicates the transition metals here. So here it will indicates the transition metals. Okay, these ligands are called chelants. Okay, these ligands EDTA, ethylene diamine tetraacetate, these ligands are called chelants, CHELANTS, chelants. Are so it can be treated as a chelants or chelators, chelating agents. So otherwise chelating agents, otherwise we can give it as a sequestering agents. Okay, they are all usually organic compounds. Okay, but this is not necessary, as in case of zinc, and it's used as a maintenance therapy to prevent the absorption of copper in Wilson's disease. Okay. So chelation is useful in applications such as providing a nutritional supplement in chelation therapy to remove the toxic metals from the body. Okay, if you see the explanation, they given as complex of drug molecules can't cross the natural membrane. Okay, natural membrane barrier, they render the drug biological ineffectivity. Okay, so by this, the rate of absorption is proportional to the concentration of the free drug molecule. This means the diffusion of the drug. So due to reversibility of the complexation, equilibrium between the free drug and the drug complex has to make. So drug plus complexing agent that gives a drug complex here. Okay, so a complexation reduces the rate of absorption of the drug but not affect the availability of the drug. So these are the important criteria if you see for a chelating agents. Okay, so for example, if you have, so when metals like lead, mercury, iron and arsenic build up in your body, so they can be a toxic. No, chelation therapy is a treatment that uses medicine to remove these metals so they don't make you risk. Some alternative healthcare provides, so treat heart diseases and Alzheimer diseases. But they so shown very little evidence it works or not. Okay, so then how it works, the chelation? The chelation therapy uses special drugs that binds to the metals in our body. Okay, for example, we have dimercaprol. So this is a drug we are going to use to remove the arsenic poisoning. Okay, this is one of the condition, so in which we are going to remove the arsenic poisoning in our body. Okay, then apart from that, so we have a series of alternatives in order to remove the heavy metal poisonings in our body. Okay, so these heavy metals normally that can't be filterized, so by the excretory system we have to make on a soluble complex so that it can be eliminated easily. Okay, so by this we are using a chelants. So these chelants, so we act as a ligands and going to make the bond with these metals. So they are going to leads to a coordination covalent bond. So this will help in the formation of a complex. So finally, that leads to the elimination of your heavy metals from the body. Okay. So if you see in biochemistry and microbiology, virtually all metallo enzymes are future metals that are chelated usually to peptides or cofactors and prosthetic groups. Why this point I am included now? So we have to get an idea, because in our body is made up of a series of metals, then how they are going to compensate. So this type of okay, so virtually all metallo enzymes future metals that are chelated usually to peptides or cofactors and prosthetic groups. Such chelating agents include the porphyrin rings in hemoglobin and chlorophyll. Many microbial species produce water soluble pigments that serves as chelating agents. So these are reason how they are going to withstand this thing. Okay. So then if you are going to see, so then apart from that, our chelating agents, what it's going to do? So a metal ion in solution, suppose we are going to take a metal ion in solution, does not exit in isolation but in combination with ligands such as solvent molecule or simple ions. So for example, so we have the metal in a solution, so it does not exit in free state, so we need a ligand in order to bind, so to get in a soluble form chelating group, so we need that. So giving rise to a complex ions are a coordinating bonds here. So these all bonds are coordinate bonds, coordinate covalent bonds. These complex contain a central atom. The M indicates the metal here. M indicates the metal ion. Often a transition metal and a cluster of ions are neutral molecules that's going to surround it. So the metal that's going to surrounded by, so this may be a neutral molecules or ions. Okay, an important and interesting example of this is chelating agents. So ligands which are able to form a two or more coordinate covalent bonds with a metal ion. So one of the most common of this is 1,2 diaminoethane. 1,2 diaminoethane. This is one of the common example we have, diaminoethane. So how it has to be, how it's going to make the bond? For example, we have the metal, so we have diamino, so we have here it's going to make the bond with diaminoethane. So this is the bond, this is the favorable interaction that's going to make with it. Okay, this chelating agent is going to favor in a solubilized form of this molecule. So due to this, favorable conditions, it can be used in the therapy. Chelation therapy is a medical procedure that involves the administration of chelating agent to remove heavy metals from the body. Okay, I think you got the point. So what is the need to include the chelation therapy? So mostly it is a proceed in clinical toxicology. Also, chelation therapy is a preferred medical treatment for metal poisoning, including acute mercury. Okay, so acute mercury poisoning. Okay, so acute mercury poisoning, iron, arsenic, iron. So we have the arsenic. So then followed by the uranium. So then plutonium. So uranium, plutonium, then other toxic metal poisons. So we are going to see now, so what are the antidotes, favorable antidotes we can provide. So that means the drugs that are going to act on these heavy metals. For example, we have arsenic poisoning. So what we have to take? We have to take dimercaprol. So we are going to take dimercaprol. So di, so indicates the presence of 2-sulfur moiety here. Dimercaprol, OL, indicates the presence of an alcohol group. So now it's going to make a bond with the arsenic. So it's going to make the bond with arsenic here. Dimercaprol in which the sulfur is going to eliminate the proton. So in order to get the sulfide form, the arsenic is going to make a bond with the dimercaprol, arsenic dimercaprol. So this entire complex is in soluble form and can be eliminated easily. So this is one of the reason. Then in addition to that, we have 8-hydroxyquinoline. We have 8-hydroxyquinoline. So what it's going to do? 8-hydroxyquinoline and its analogs acts as a antibacterial and antifungal agents. We know that it is an antibacterial. So then antifungal. So nice. Okay, here it's going to make a complex with iron or copper. Okay, that's why in order to get the bacteriostatic activity there. Undesirable side effect, if you see the undesirable side effects that caused by the drugs which chelates with metals. So for example, a side effect of hydralazine. So it is an antihypertensive agent. Okay, so when hydralazine as an antihypertensive agent, is the formation of anemia. So leads to anemia, and this is due to what may be the reason? This is due to a chelation of the drug with iron. It's going for the chelation of the drug with iron. So that leads to the anemia, deficiency of iron. So that's why doctor used to advise, if they are going to take hydralazine, so we have to go for iron supplement if need. So phenobarbital, so then phenobarbital forms a non-absorbable complex with PEG, polyethylene glycol, the grade 4000. So in which our phenobarbitals is going to form, a non-absorbable complex. Okay, it's going to form a non-absorbable complex. So that leads to accumulation. Then calcium with the EDTA form complex, which is increase the permeability of membrane. Okay, these are the reasons. If you see the applications where it's going to be applicable, so the anti-helminthic activity of hexyl resorcinol, bactericidal activity of cationic quaternary ammonium compounds, then followed by bactericidal activity of aliphatic alcohols, disinfectant action of phenols and cresol, bile salt solution of approximately, if you see the physiological concentration, that has to be greater, so which is going to enhance the dissolution rate of a poorly water soluble drugs. If you see those one, griseofulvin is one of the best example, followed by hexastrol, by a process called micellar solubilization effect. So this is the facilitate of the chelation complex with these drugs. So this about the chelation. So how we are going to carry on? Okay, this is about the entire thing. So this data confirms that so chelation plays a very important role. Okay, so if you see the chelation effect, it is an enhanced affinity of chelating ligands for a metal ion compared to the affinity of a collection of similar non-chelating ligands for the same metal. So this is very, very important. Okay, so we know that how it's going to act. So then how we are going to implement this chelation in the body. Okay, so now we are going to see bioisosteres. So what are bioisosteres? Okay, so bioisosteres are chemical substituents. So these are the chemical substituents with a similar physical or chemical properties, which produce broadly similar biological properties to another chemical compounds. Okay, it has to resemble almost as that of the similar chemical compounds. Here we are going to replace an atom, so that has to show the similar and existence molecule. existent molecular property in order to achieve the same effect. So by bioisosterism, we are going to reduce the toxicity, change the bioavailability, modify the activity of the lead compound. Okay, these are about the entire so chemistry of bioisosterism. Then, so replacement or modification of a functional group with other groups having similar properties is said to be a isosteric. That for the bio means that's a bioisosteric replacement. So that given by the scientist Langmuir. So he has been explained this overall concept. Okay. So if you see this one, so we have a classical isosteres. So these are the molecules or ions with a similar shape and often a similar electronic properties. So we have that classical isosteres here. So we have an example. For example, if I am going to replace a hydrogen, I am going to replace the hydrogen with fluorine, then what going to happen? Okay, so I am going to replace fluorine with hydrogen with fluorine. While replacing this, so we have the condition that a replacement of hydrogen atom with fluorine atom at the site of metabolic oxidation in a drug candidate that prevent such a metabolism from taking place. Okay, this is the main intention, because the fluorine atom is similar in size to hydrogen. So this gives the molecule is not significantly affected by the replacement. So leaving the desired biological activity unaffected. So this is the main intention. So if you see the classical bioisosteres, how they has been classified as a univalent atoms, then followed by a bivalent atom. So we have the examples for univalent chlorine, then bromine, iodine. So methyl, amine, hydroxyl, then sulfide. So bivalent, if you see the ethers, alkyl amines, alkyl sulfides, then followed by acetamines, esters. So these are the examples. If you see the trivalent atoms and groups to achieve the bioisosterism, so we have nitrogen and we have the group methyl group CH, then phosphorus, then arsenic. So tetravalent atoms and groups, so we can take the carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus. Okay, so in order to achieve the tetravalency, so if you consider the ring equivalents, so we have the rings for the benzene, then followed by pyrrolidine, then so we have the thiol ring. So after that we have the ethylene, sulfur, oxygen, then NH and CH groups. Okay, if you see the application of a classical bioisosteres in drug design, so we have words previously, we have to maintain the solubility, we have to maintain biological effect and bioavailability. So entire these factors comes to make a new drug design by taking its lead molecule. So for example, we have the drug carbutamide. We have the drugs carbutamide. So to this carbutamide, so we have the drug carbutamide. Here we have so acetamide. We have the side chain. Let's draw the nucleus. We have the carbutamide here. I'm going to draw the carbutamide structure. So now here a replacement of amine group by methyl. So we are going to replace amine group by methyl. Replacement of amyl group by methyl group, we are going to transform this carbutamide into, it is a carbutamide. So this carbutamide is going to transform into tall butamide, tall butamide. Okay, so we are going to see an enhanced drug activity by this one. Okay, similarly, we have another drug. We are going to take a guanine, a replacement of a, so we are going to draw the guanine structure now. So in this guanine, so pyrimidine structure joined to an imidazole nucleus. So imagine it is an imidazole nucleus. So entire nucleus will becomes guanine. So this is an guanine here. Okay, now we are going to replace guanine hydroxyl group. Guanine hydroxyl group with sulfur SH group. So that going to give 6. That going to give six thioguanine. Okay, so we are going to see an increased activity here also. Then similarly, for example, halogens like chlorine, fluorine and bromine, and cyanide, ethers, sulfur, then carbonyl groups. Carbonyl groups, hydroxyl, NHCO, and alcohol groups, these are all plays an important role to act as an bioisosteres. Okay, so these are about the classical bioisosteres. Next we have non-classical bioisosteres, what they are going to do. They do not obey the steric and electronic definition of classic isosteres. Okay, so here non-classical, so are the functional groups with dissimilar valence electronic configuration, but with specific characters like electronic properties, physiochemical property of the molecule, a spatial arrangement, then functional moiety for biological activity. So these are the concerns for non-classical bioisosteres. Okay, so next if you are going to see the topic as protein binding. So what is a protein binding? So how it's going to do for a drug? So normally, in general, the drug has to be going for administered into the body. It has to go and reach to the targets by a proper carriers. So we have the carriers inside the body. So imagine we have the proteins. So those are nothing but albumin and globulin. Okay, so these are reversible bindings of protein. So this leads to a reversible binding of protein with that of the drug. So that gives a protein drug complex. Okay, which is an reversible. So that's going to lead to the target there. So depending on whether the drug is weak or strong, so it may be the weak or strong, so acid or base, or it may be the neutral, it can bind to the single blood protein to multiple proteins. Okay, so it going to bind to various proteins. Here we have a serum albumin, then we have we have the acid glycoproteins and lipoproteins. The most significant protein involved in the binding of a drug is albumin, so that we have to consider. So here the plasma protein binding referred to the degree to which the medication attaches it to the protein within the blood. A drug efficacy may be affected by the degree to which it binds. So this is the important factor. So less bound to a drug, the more efficiency it can transfer cell membrane or diffuses. A common blood proteins the drug going to bind, we have been seen here. Okay, apart from that, these globulins, we have the substituents like alpha, beta and gamma. Okay, so these are for the entire protein drug. So complex formation, the protein drug can influence the drug's biological half-life. So here if you see, no, the binding can influence the biological half-life here. So it's going to influence the biological half-life. But then what going to happen? The bound portion may act as a reservoir from which the drug is slowly released as the unbound form. So the unbound form is being metabolized and are excreted from the body. The bound fraction will be released in order to maintain the equilibrium condition. Okay, by this way, so we are going to see the protein binding and volume of distribution. So for a drug, so this about the protein binding. So if you see, so how it's going to establish, so how it's going to happen. So let's draw if you are going to administer a drug into the body. So the drug is going to reach to the gut. Then after that, so imagine it is a compartment here. So this is one of the compartment. Then it has to go and reach to another compartment. So where we are going to generate unbound, where we are going to generate unbound drug to unbound drug to bound drug, bound drug. So then here it's going for a metabolism now. It's going for metabolism. So from this metabolism, so if it is a prodrug, it's going to transform into an active form. It's going to transform into an active form of the drug. Active form of the drug followed by inactive form of the drug. So followed by inactive form of the drug. So finally, so after showing the action, it has to be eliminated from the body through by proper excretion. Okay, so this drug after transformation, it has to go and reach to the receptors. It has to go and reach to the receptor. Go and reach to the receptor in order to show therapeutic effects followed by the side effects. Okay, our main intention not to show the side effects. It has to elicit the therapeutic effect. Okay, so this about the entire action of our protein. Proteins, so it has to go and carry on your drug and it has to transform itself into an entire thing. Then how it's going to do? The plasma drug bound to protein, so that's a free drug. So in intestinal fluid, the drug bound protein complex is going to happen. So after reversible reaction in target cell, the drug is going to be eliminated and it's going to be transformed into an active and inactive form. The active form is going to show its activity at a particular receptor. Okay, this is the importance of protein. So we have to frame the drug in such a way. So your drug has to be accepted by the proteins. So by modification of by the modification of chemical structure. So by the modification of chemical structure here. So we are going to change. So we are going to change it into an plasma protein binding, so that gives the parameters, remaining parameters, partition parameters, log P, so then pKa, so product of ionic concentration. So here this gives a clearance, then absorption, clearance and absorption. Here, so the plasma protein binding, so no change in a free drug concentration, but here, so by alteration of all this, so clearance and absorption, clearance, then followed by absorption, clearance, followed by absorption. So here we are going to see the free drug. So free drug concentration changes. Okay, so this is the entire thing about the protein binding. We are going to end the topic now. Tomorrow we are going to continue.